In 1985 kreeg Brodsky een mapje reproducties van Willings werk onder ogen. Brodsky zei, deze man is mijn geestverwant. Hij schildert wat ik tracht te dichten.
Het zit er allemaal in, hè?
Het zit er allemaal in, ja. Elk wenkbrauw haartje. Ja. Elk fijn lijntje.
En dat is toch, als je een mal direct op de klei maakt, ja. dan heb je het verlies niet, hè? Van het eerste schietsel.
Elk rimpeltje zit erin.
Ja.
De laatste bewerkingsfase is het patineren. Een specialistisch vakwerk. De diep bronzen kleur die de beelden zullen krijgen, moet onder hoge temperatuur van het materiaal worden ingebrand. Daarna worden de hete beelden met etsende zuren bespoten, waardoor de kleur in het oppervlak van het beeld dringt.
Je gaat voor de camera.
Een laatste warming up en cooling down. En Jozef Brodsky zal in het Amsterdamse West-Indisch Huis zichzelf publiekelijk onthullen.
First of all, on the subject of a poet, the poet, and so forth. A great American poet, perhaps the greatest American poet of the century. Robert Frost once remarked that to call yourself or to allow somebody else to call you a poet is about as immodest and reprehensible as to allow somebody or as to call yourself a good man. Because, well, a poet, the word itself, carries a whole lot of positive connotations. It's somebody who is good, who is perhaps even better than the others. Well, so it's, one has a tremendous difficulty with being regarded, or at least publicly referred to as a poet, not to mention the poet. Well, that's one thing. Secondly, about indeed the spectacle. How should I put to you? To unveil a bust of your own, well, well, this is this doesn't happen very often in one's lifetime. Well, for that to have a bust, well, I don't really know. It happened to the Roman emperors, of course, yeah, and presumably to people of great consequence. Well, it happened several times, I believe. Well, but I never could imagine that it will, well, that I'll be doing this. No, I think you will see this procedure in your life very often. So let's, how should I put it? Let me do it. Yeah, well, let me do it. Well, all right. The only respect in which this head is different from the one I carry on my shoulders is that it doesn't speak. Perhaps just as well from your point of view. Also, I'm afraid it can't kiss.
So let me do it again.
Let me talk for 5 minutes, can I? Yeah, okay, but in the city. It's extraordinary, the similarity is quite substantial. The only thing is, of course, that in Petersburg, the river is far wider than Amstel. But other than that, well, there are plenty of canals, plenty of bridges, plenty of islands. It's something on the order of 100 islands. So not to mention the very simple fact that a part of Petersburg is simply called precisely this. It's called New Holland. And in that part of the city, I spent quite a number of years. Well, so there is that sort of affinity. But when I saw Wehling's paintings, I saw something else which sent me immediately off. And it happened not only after seeing the postcards and returning to the States. In fact, I began to write that poem in Mr. Verheul's apartment that summer when I stayed there. I did. Well, I think I've written the first draft of it there. Well, I came to New York only to finish it off. So it's quite congenial, the whole thing. But there is something about Wehling's art, about Wehling's painting, that I would like to speak about, except that I'm not qualified, simply as I'm not an art critic. Well, I don't have even proper terminology. It's the sense of isolation or of autonomy that oozes from those paintings. Autonomy of the statues, autonomy of the buildings, autonomy of the sky. Well, which is, it's a sense of total human mind's autonomy. It's the landscape. They're landscapes mainly, those paintings. They have tremendous strength. Well, it's easiest and one of the stupidest things, presumably, would be to link Wehling to surrealistic tradition. Indeed, some of his paintings do suggest to you somebody like Delvaux or Magritte. They are not that. Well, they are, to my eye at least, they are far greater, they are far more chilling paintings. And in a sense, I thought that I recognized in those landscapes, my humble self. This is, if I were a painter, this is what I would do on the canvas. For that reason, I went to write a poem. It's those are the landscapes devoid of human presence. They're in a sense, well, sort of a post-mortem of culture, post-mortem of civilization. That's what they look like. Well, sort of somewhat, in a peculiar way, there is tremendous posthumous aspect to those paintings. Well, I don't really know what it had to do with the artist's own perception of the reality, but this is perhaps the only attitude towards reality. Well, it's a painting, those are the paintings of the, if you will, of the ideal landscapes. Because every city, every landscape, every building, every statue, they are egoists. They don't want an interference. And somehow it coincided or rhymed in my head with what I see in this world. In fact, well, the more I learned about Wehling's life, that is not much, the more it suggested to me that, he lived my life already, that I don't have to do much on my own. That is, this life of mine has had a precedent. It's quite in tune with that, quite logical, in that posthumous sense of the landscape for me to unveil something rather of posthumous nature that is the best of my own. May sound grim, but so this is the case indeed. I'm terribly, not because I like myself. In fact, my sentiments towards myself are rather, how should I put to you? I wouldn't brag about my sentiments. Well, maybe because of that, because I don't like what this frame contains. Well, I'm glad to see it the best because it's somewhat better than me. Not only because it's slightly younger. Okay. All I can say, and I would like to say, simply, there are not that many words in the language to be adequate, to say something adequate to the sentiment of the occasion. So all I can say to Mrs. Wehling, thank you very much. Okay. No. На выставке Карла Вейлинга почти пейзаж, количество фигур, в нем возникающих, идет на убыль с наплывом статуй. Мрамор белокур, как наизнанку вывернутый уголь и местность Мницы Северной, плато, гипербореи, взъерошившие капусту, все так горизонтально, что никто вас не прижмет к взволнованному бюсту. Возможно, это будущее, фон, раскаяние, вместе со служивцу, глухого, но отчетливого вон, внезапного приема джиу-джитсу. И это город будущего, сад, чьи заросли рассматриваешь в оба, как ящерица в тропиках фасад гостиницы, тем паче небоскреба. Возможно, также прошлое, предел, отчаяние, общая вершина, глаголы в длинной очереди кэл, улегшаяся буря крепдышина. И это царство прошлого, тропы, заглохнувшие в действительности лужи, хранящие отражение скрупы, увиденной яичницей снаружи. Бесспорно перспектива, календарь, вернее, из воспалившихся гортаний, туннель в психологическую даль, свободную от наших очертаний, и голосу подробнее, чем взор, знакомому с ландшафтом неуспеха, с подручней выбрать больше из зол, в расчете на чувствительное эхо, возможно, натюрморт издалека, все в рамку заключенное частично, мертво и неподвижно облака, река, над ней кружащаяся птичка, равнина, часто именно она, принять другую форму не умея, становится добычей полотна, открытки, оправданием Птолемея. Возможно, зебра моря или тигр, смесь скинутого платья и преграды, облизывает чиколотки икр к закату неспособной балюстрады. И время мнится к вечеру, жара, сняв потный повод с пыльной наковальни, настойчивое соло комара кончается овациями спальни. Возможно, декорация дают причины, нечувствительность к разлуке, со следствием, приветствуя уют, певцы не столь нежны, сколь близоруки, и дозвучит, как временная от, блестящая, как капля из-под крана, вибрируя над проволокой нот, парит лунообразная сопрано. Бесспорно, что портрет на беспрекрас, поверхность, чьи землистые оттенки, естественно, приковывает глаз. Тем более поставленного к стенке, поодаль, как уступ к белизне, клубятся, сбившись тучу, олимпийцы, спиной чуя брошенный извне, взгляд живописца, взгляд самоубийцы, что в сущности и есть автопортрет, шаг в сторону от собственного тела, повернутый к вам в профиль табурет, вид издали на жизнь, что пролетела, вот это и зовется мастерство. Способность не страшиться процедуры, небытия, как формы своего отсутствия, списав его с натуры.